Welcome to part 2. In this video, we are going to continue with the alignment, set the ground plane, scale the scene, and set up the reconstruction region. The next step is to align the images. I can just click on Align Images from the Workflow tab or the Alignment tab. But before I do that, let's take a look at the alignment settings. Right now, we have the default settings. They are good for most cases, but if you are having problems with the alignment, getting more components, and you're 100% sure that your images are good with enough overlap, you can bump some of these settings up. I will set the max feature per image to 80,000 and set the image overlap to low. Everything else is fine. Here in the preselectors features, I will add half of the max features per image, so in this case, 40,000. When the first alignment did not go well, I would delete the created components and enable force component rematch. But right now, I didn't align the images, so I'll keep it disabled. Sometimes you can change the detector sensitivity, but this depends if your images have enough contrast features. In my case, medium is fine. I would use high sensitivity for blank walls of buildings. Be careful with the ultra sensitivity, as it can add false positives from the noise in the images. I will keep the distortion model set to Brown 3. If you are using fisheye lenses, you should choose the division distortion model. Camera priors are enabled by default, but my images don't have any priors right now. For example, I usually disable the camera priors for drone images with low quality GPS EXIF metadata after the first initial alignment when combining with ground control points. These draft mode settings control the draft button up here. Draft can be used for on-site preview alignment on a laptop to check if you have the object covered from all angles or if you need to add more images. Okay, now I can close this. I mentioned that I will show you how to group the images. Let's get to it. When I click on images, I have an option to group them, ungroup them, or force constant calibrations. By grouping the images, I will tell RealityCapture that all the images in the group have the same properties. Even when all were shot with the same camera, there will be some small deviations because of small movements of optics, mechanical movements, or temperature changes. That is why I usually group the images for the first alignment and then ungroup them for further alignments. This minus one next to the calibration group and lens group means that the cameras are not grouped. Any other number in these fields means that the cameras are grouped. Take a look at what happens when I click on group. Minus one changed to zero. Now they are grouped together. If I switch between multiple images, you can see the group is still zero. Notice that by default, the lens distortion model is set to no lens distortion with prior set to approximate. This means that RealityCapture will try to find a solution where the lens distortion is close to zero as possible. But this is not realistic if the distortion is visible with the naked eye. In such case, you should either define proper distortion coefficients or set the lens prior to unknown. Now I can close the settings and align images. The alignment finished, and one of the 2D views changed to a 3D view containing the sparse point cloud. To move the point cloud or model, simply click with the left mouse button in the 3D view and drag the mouse. This way, you can move to the sides or forward and backward. If you want to go up or down, press the Control key and drag the mouse up and down. To rotate the view, use the right mouse button. Zoom in and out using the mouse scroll wheel. To change the pivot, double-click in the 3D view. Now I accidentally clicked on the reconstruction region and moved it out of the view. When this happens, just undo by pressing Ctrl plus Z on the English keyboard. RealityCapture created this component 0, which is containing 144 images out of 144 images. When I click on it, its properties will be displayed in the 1D's view. The properties contain the alignment report and settings used for the alignment. In the report, you can see more information about total projections, track length, errors, if the alignment is georeferenced or not, and the alignment time. The settings section shows the settings used for the alignment. Now it is a good time to save the project. To do that, click on the RealityCapture icon and click on Save. Since I am saving the project for the first time, I have to choose where I want to save the project. I will create a new folder next to my images, rename it to Project, and I will save the project in the folder with the name statue. Now I will ungroup the images and check one image if it is ungrouped. Yes, the group calibration and lens group are set to -1. Good, now I will align the images again. Reality Capture created a new component. The first one was created with grouped images and the second one with ungrouped images. We can compare the errors, and the errors are lower in the second component. You can do multiple alignments to lower the error and change the max feature reprojection error to lower the errors even further. Now back to the tutorial and click on continue. Here is more information about what I already talked about, so I can click on continue again. The next step is set the ground plane. What I like to do is to switch to one of the orthographic views instead of the perspective view. First, I will switch to the top view. The views can be switched in the 3D scene context tab. To define the ground plane, go to the Reconstruction tab and click on Set Ground Plane. This will activate the ground plane widget. In this view, the front is from the top, so I will rotate the point cloud using the ground plane widget and also move it to the center of the grid. Now I will switch to one of the side views. By pressing number 6 on the numeric keyboard, I will switch to the front view. Number 4 will switch to the left view. It looks already good, so I will only adjust it slightly. The ground plane is defined, so I can disable the ground plane widget. To switch back to the perspective view, press 0 on the numeric keyboard. Now I am going to define the scale of the object using control points and the defined distance. Go to the Alignment tab. Activate the control point tool, and now when I move the mouse cursor over the 3D view, Reality Capture previews the control point's location in the 2D view. I will use the folder meter stick to define two control points and use them to define the distance between them. The first one will be on one end at 10 centimeters. I don't have to place it that accurately because I will adjust its position on multiple images. The second one will be at the other end at 1 meter and 10 centimeters, so the defined distance will be exactly 1 meter. The control points are placed, so I will disable the control points tool. In the 1D's view, I have image suggestions that contain the control points. I will go one by one and adjust the control points' positions. I will select the first image, and now when I use the down arrow key, I will move through them. To adjust the control points' position, I will click on it and hold the left mouse button. Move it to the desired location and release the left mouse button. Press down arrow key to switch to the next one. Click on the control point and move it to the same place. Now, without releasing the left mouse button, I can press the down arrow key to confirm the control point's position and simultaneously switch to the next image. I will repeat the same for other images. As I am adjusting and confirming the position of the control points, in the 1D's view, you can see the calculated error. Everything under 2 pixels is in the green. These 4 confirmed images are enough, but I can quickly check the other images as well. These are not very good, but this one could be used, but it is not necessary. Now I can select a control point in the 1D's view and click on Clear Suggestions because I don't want to see the unconfirmed suggestions. Now I need to do the same for the second control point. The first image is not the best, the second and the fourth one also. Finally, the fifth image can be used. This one as well. And the last one is also good. This image could be also used, but the 3 is enough. Again, click on the control point and clear suggestions. Now I can define the distance between these two control points. It can be done in multiple ways. Create distance in the 1D's view and select the A and B points. When I press Enter, the distance will be displayed in the 3D view. This is the first way. I will delete it and show you the second way. Click on Define Distance in the ribbon and drag it from point 0 to point 1 directly in the 3D view. Be sure to click on the created control point, otherwise it will create a new one. Again, I define the distance constraint between these two control points from point 0 to point 1. The third way is to define the distance by connecting the control points on an image in the 2D view. For example, this image. I will delete the distance again, activate the Define Distance tool, and connect the points directly on this one image. Now I have to type in the actual distance between these two points in the 1D's view. So if I check one more time, here is 10 centimeters minus 1 millimeter, and on the other end I have 1 meter, 10 centimeters, minus 1 millimeter. So that is exactly 1 meter. Now to apply it, I will disable the tool and click on update. The distance between point 0 and point 1 was updated to 1 meter. Before reconstruction, I am going to adjust the reconstruction region. There are multiple ways how to set it up. Right now, it is huge and is containing parts that do not interest me. What I can do is go to the reconstruction tab, clear it, and set it up automatically. Now when I click on it, the box widget will appear and I can use it to adjust the reconstruction region. I can move each side of the region, rotate it, or move it. I will clear it again, and this time I will going to set it on the grid. First, I will click on the nearest corner, then the far corner, and finally adjust the height of the region. To fine-tune it, I will again use the orthographic views. First from the top, next from the side, and switch back to the perspective view. The reconstruction region is set, and that will be the end of this video. In the next video, we will start with reconstruction.